Greetings, greetings. This is Jim Vrettos. I'm your host for The Radical Imagination. We're here with you every Sunday evening at 8 p.m. on MNN. And I'm so grateful and so happy that you're here to join us for another one of our shows in which we are offering alternative progressive narratives on what might be and what can happen in this country and in this world. And today we're going to show you a piece from the Muhammad Ali funeral in which a guest of ours, he was just on our show a couple weeks ago, Rabbi Michael Lerner, who is the co-editor of Tikkun magazine, the founder of the Progressive Network of Spiritual Progressives, he was asked to give one of the talks, the speeches, at the Muhammad Ali funeral, Louisville, just, I guess, about a week ago or so. And we had him on this show a couple weeks ago. We didn't know at that time, he didn't know at that time, that he was going to be speaking at the Ali funeral. So what we want to do is open up the show with his talk at the Ali funeral, which, if you saw it, literally brought down the house. And then after that, I want to talk with my special guest today, Mel Blackman, the founder of the Burning House Project, on healing, healing and transforming the world. So let's put on this incredible clip from Rabbi Michael Lerner, the founder of Tikkun magazine, at the Ali funeral just about a week ago.
Master of compassion, God of compassion, send your blessings to Muhammad Ali, and send your blessings to all who mourn for him, and send your blessings for all the millions and millions of people who mourn for him all over this planet. Amen. I come here speaking as a representative of American Jews, and to say that American Jews played an important role of solidarity with the African-American struggles in this country, and that we today stand in solidarity with Islamic community in this country and all around the world. We will not tolerate politicians or anyone else putting down Muslims and blaming Muslims for a few people. We know what it's like to be demeaned. We know what it's like to have a few people who act against the highest visions of our tradition to then be identified as the value of the entire tradition. And one of the reasons that we in Tikkun magazine, a magazine of liberal and progressive Jews, but also an interfaith magazine, have called upon the United States to stand up to the part of the Israeli government that is oppressing Palestinians is that we as Jews understand that our commitment is to recognize that God has created everyone in God's image, and that everyone is equally precious, and that means the Palestinian people as well as all other people on the planet. I know the people of Louisville have a special relationship to Muhammad Ali, and I had a personal relationship in the 60s when both of us were indicted by the federal government for our various stands against the war in Vietnam. I want to say that although he was cheered on as the heavyweight champion of the world, you know, the truth is that in all the honor to him, but heavyweight champions of the world come and go, and sports heroes come and go. There was something about Muhammad Ali that was different. At the key moment when he had that recognition, he used it to stand up to an immoral war and say, "No, I won't go." And it's for that reason that tens of millions of Americans who don't particularly care about boxing, about Muhammad Ali, because he was a person who was willing to risk a great honor that he got and a great fame that he got to stand up for the beliefs that he had, to speak truth to power when the rest of the people around him said, no, you're going to lose your championship. And it was taken away from him for 5 years. But he stood up and was willing to take that kind of a risk because of that kind of moral integrity. So I want to say, how do we honor Muhammad Ali? And the answer is, the way to honor Muhammad Ali is to be Muhammad Ali today. And that means us, everyone here and everyone listening. It's up to us to continue that ability to speak truth to power. We must speak out, refuse to follow the path of conformity to the rules of the game in life. We must refuse to follow the path of conformity. Tell the 1% who own 80% of the wealth of this country that it's time to share that wealth. Tell the politicians who use violence worldwide and then preach into nonviolence to the oppressed that it's time for them to end their drone warfare and every other form of warfare, to close our bases around the world, to bring the troops home. Tell those who created mass incarceration that it's time to create a guaranteed income for everyone in our society. Tell judges to let out of prison the many African Americans swept up by racist police and imprisoned by racist judges. And many of them in prison today for offenses like possessing marijuana that white people get away with all the time. Tell our elected officials to imprison those who authorized torture and those who ran the big banks and investment companies that caused the economic collapse of 2008. Tell the leaders of Turkey to stop killing the Kurds. Tell Israeli Prime Minister Netanyahu that the way to get security is for Israel is to stop the occupation of the West Bank and help create a Palestinian state. Tell the next president of the United States that she Tell the next president of the United States that she should seek a constitutional amendment to make all national and state elections funded by Congress and the state legislatures and all other sources of money be banned, including money from corporations, from individuals, all other money, make it all public funding. Tell her that the way to achieve homeland security is not for us to try new ways of domination. The strategy of domination of the world of the other to get security has been tried for the last 10,000 years, and it doesn't work. The way to get security is for the United States to become known as the most generous and caring country in the world, not the most powerful. And we can start with a global and domestic Marshall Plan to once and for all end global and domestic poverty, homelessness, hunger, inadequate education, inadequate health care. So I want to, as chair of the Interfaith Network of Spiritual Progressives, by the way, spiritualprogressives.org, come and join us, spiritualprogressives.org, I want to affirm our commitment to the well-being of all Muslims on this planet, as well as the people of all faiths and secular humanists as well. We wish to pay honor to Muslims of the world as they continue today the fast of Ramadan and join with them in mourning the loss and celebrating the life of Muhammad Ali, a great fighter for justice and peace. Peace be upon him, peace be upon the Prophet Muhammad, peace be upon all of humanity, and peace on all of us.
Well, Mel, I'm so glad you're here.
Thanks for having me.
Today, well, and we've just watched this incredible speech by Rabbi Lerner, powerful message of healing, right? Of repairing the world through love and nurturing and caring, and power is not to be seen in terms of violence and humiliation and domination, and so on and so on. And it wowed the crowd. It was just unbelievable reaction. And presumably, as millions and tens of hundreds of millions of people around the world resonated to this message. It seems that the world, so many of us in the world, is crying for this message and the specifics to bring it about. And yet, as Michael says, thousands of years of history has not brought this about. And we are now, as you well know, in a bitter campaign where there is an opposition to this mindset. And let's face it, this might be a very, very close election. And so on. So we seem to be at a crossroads here. And this show, The Radical Imagination, is an attempt to deal with these incredible battles and ideas. And you're certainly part of that struggle. And I want so much for you to hear. I want to hear what you think about this message in terms of your own life work. And we'll get onto more of your specific program here in just a few minutes. But what did you think about this progressive rabbi speaking to essentially a non-Jewish, if you will, non-white audience and resonating? And his message, I think, is so clear for all humanity. How'd you feel hearing this?
I felt like the audience felt, you know, it's to hear a message of the only answer for all the ills of the world is always good, you know. And then to hear from a religious leader, you know, to say that, you know, publicly, and even involving situations that involve his own people and other people,
that's important, isn't it?
Yeah.
Tell me just a little about why is it important for a white Jewish spiritual leader to resonate within the black and the Muslim community?
Yeah, because the main problem that the world has is disunity, and the main part about the disunity is one, they got one side or the other side or both sides that really don't want to hear what the other side is talking about. They're not trying to understand what the other side is talking about, because they have one mindset, and the one mindset is like, you know, this is my platform, and I'm sticking to it no matter what.
And we're fearful, suspicious of the other side. So here's somebody now who is crossing no man's land here.
Yeah.
And the love and outpouring is just incredible. It seems like we're all craving this to happen, and yet so few politicians and spiritual leaders, academics, you name it, are capable of doing. What's on all sides, for that matter? It's an incredible dilemma, isn't it?
Yeah. The answer to that is like what I do with the Burning House Project.
Yeah.
I'm not so much. When I speak in different forums, including this one, I'm not talking so much about as far as what they're doing, you know, because we already know what they're doing. You know, they're making a mess out of everything. You know, the people themselves, right? You know, that's the part that I don't understand when it comes to government. the people themselves have the power to change, you know, their own circumstances, you know. But we depend on these politicians and these elected officials to change things for us. When in a lot of cases we keep putting the same people back in office, or somebody similar back in office to try to change things for us instead of getting to some person. That's why I like.
That's a great point.
Yeah, that's why I like in particular something about, and I mention this a lot, about the basically the Hasidic Jewish community. They basically vote in a block, you know, which you probably know. I mean, like if they like a candidate because this candidate is good for our people collectively,
right.
We will as a group we will vote and put our vote in your and put you in there.
Yeah.
But if you don't, if you're just running your mouth and just saying that you're going to do this and don't do it, the next election comes up, right? We're going to vote you out.
They know who's authentic,
right,
and has a certain integrity, at least for them. Now you also you live.
Yes.
In Crown Heights,
right.
near that
yes.
community, yes, right.
Yes.
So you see this sort of political alliances,
yes,
and strategy operating.
Yes.
Now, so what do you make of that? That is a
I admire it.
You admire.
Yeah.
Okay. So they're not. They are in a state of unity in a sense politically.
Right.
They know where they're. Positions are and what,
right.
what who they want to have in there, and so that's interesting. Now you've also said though that government, by and large, doesn't really respond to the needs of the great masses.
Right.
And certainly, we hear Michael and then all around the world that message resonates. Yet, when we make that next step to our governments, the governments of the world, that doesn't seem to be happening in so many places around the world, including here.
Yeah.
And yet you, again, have given us this example of the Hasidic community. So help me understand the connection. When can government respond in a positive way to the needs of the great, great masses of people?
Well, like I said, when a person, when a candidate is put into office, that's gonna will actually go along with what the needs of the people are, right? That's the kind of candidate that you want in there. And
but so many of them tell us.
But that's my point. See,
yes.
I'll give. I won't mention the name, but like say up in Harlem, right?
There's mention the name.
Okay.
Okay.
Up in Harlem, they have like a, Charles Rangel.
Right. There's a political campaign
right.
going
and
on.
And there's a lot of issues like even in the area where he lives, right, that have been ongoing for many years.
Right.
But yet people was continuously putting the same person into office, you know, basically because of familiarity and skin color.
And disunity among the people on these issues?
Well, there's disunity with the issues, but there's not disunity with putting the same person back in the office again.
Okay.
You know, I mean, like, you know, we're unified because, like, I'll vote for anybody who can prove, you know, first of all, you have to have a proven record of, like, you're for my people. When I say my people, it doesn't even have to be people of color, right? This community, if you have a proven record of doing things, you know, for the people in this community.
And that would mean what? Jobs,
well,
housing, education,
well, more or less,
basic
well,
human.
Well, not just that. It's just basically standing up for all those things. You know, like anything that's,
okay.
that's in favor of enhancing housing or jobs or school situations.
Okay.
And that person is consistently, you know, up front and on board with anything to make those things happen and change for the better. I'm going to vote for that person. I couldn't care less what color they are, you know, because I'm not going to keep voting for somebody, you know, because they look like me.
Right. Okay.
You know, but it would help. I mean, I'm not. Don't get me wrong. It would help. I was sure would like that. You know, if the person looked like me and they're going to do these things. But
okay. Okay.
If a person has a proven record, right, I'm going to go with that person, you know, because that's why with the presidential thing going on right now, right, it's really tricky because, like, it's like, you know, who are we going to pick? Well, I already know, like, which side I'm on because, like, one guy is just completely out there, you know, and
sure.
and I know he's not for me.
But Michael is also saying, well, maybe that other side there, although he does say when she becomes president, he's also saying, well, don't be so sure. We need to keep, make sure that she follows the needs truly of the vast majority of the people, which in the past has not been the case. And by the way, I should add, I mean, Bill Clinton, who we saw pictures of, and Hillary, for that matter, when he was in office, Michael was a major consultant to both of them on their health care bill. And as was Obama. Obama's gone to these Tikkun conferences before he was elected president, obviously, and other presidents. But those two specifically have said, we really admire the Tikkun message, basically what Michael is talking about there. Right. And I must tell you, Michael had what Jews call chutzpah to tell Bill Clinton, quote unquote, you're the goddamn president. Then do it. And he said, well, make me do it. As all these politicians seem to say. They supposedly want to do it. They have the moral integrity. They say they're going to do it. They spout all the rhetoric that, yes, we stand for this and that. And then when it comes to it, they said, well, make me do it. Make me realize that there are people out there who want this to happen. And there are. We know that. It's been going on since the 30s. The great majority of Americans have wanted a one-payer health care system. Right. And that's what Michael told the Clintons. And Obama, the great majority of people, okay, I'll start in just a minute because I want to get into specific program. We want to put on, just in a couple of minutes here, a brief tape of your program, too, and we'll try and hook in what Michael has been saying in terms of healing and the political process to your own work here. Yeah. So again, that question becomes, boy, it's like living in a mental hospital here. You're saying one thing, and people are promising, yes, we believe that, we want to do that, and yet they can't do it.
Yeah.
And we, the cycles of violence and hatred and oppression going on keep going on. So how do you bring about, can you bring this about within more traditional political struggles? Or, as you say, perhaps organizing outside of the system is the route to go and not be dependent upon these powers that be that you really can't trust, whatever party.
Okay. Well, one thing when it comes down to, see, the American people don't really realize how much power they have. And they really don't realize, because I deal with elected officials, which I'm being kind when I say that. I call, you know, there's other words I think of. But when it comes down to elected officials,
you deal with them in the sense that you want them to help and promote some of the issues, particularly as it relates to substance abuse and
all kinds of stuff.
All kinds of stuff that you're seeking their understanding and support for.
Right.
And we'll get into that in just 1 minute.
But here's the thing.
As
American people, we need to know that we're in charge. You know, we don't have to, like, you know, cater to, you know, to their understanding. Here's my understanding.
Okay.
Here's our understanding, right? We would like for you to get this done, but because elected officials like to keep their job, they really do. That's why they spend more time on rebuilding or, you know, their funds to, you know, for re-election than doing a whole bunch of other stuff. But they like to keep their job.
But when you walk in their office, great, Mel, it's great to see you. What can we do here? They're opening.
That's on their side because, like, we've heard all that nonsense before. Like, you know, what can I do for you? Or here's what I'm going to do for you, right?
Okay.
But what we as voters don't realize the power that we have, we tell them, well, listen, here's what we need to done. Here's what you said you're going to do, right? If you don't do it, right, next election we're taking you out of here.
I see.
They don't want to be taken out of there. You know, they want to stay right in that office. They want to stay there, right?
Mm-hmm.
So if the American people, you know, would get enough, you know, chutzpah to say, and because you guys work for us, right? Mm-hmm. If here's what you said you can do for us, and you didn't do it,
you're out.
Thank you, but see you later. We'll get the next guy, right? Sooner or later, they're going to get the point, because all of a sudden, if it worked out in theory, like it would work out in my head, all of a sudden you see such a change if the American people actually did that. Oh, wait a minute, this person said, you know, I'm going to play the tape back, thank God for the 21st century, right? I'm going to play the tape back of what you said you were going to do, and you didn't do it, right? So next time we're not voting for you, right? Because we already heard what you said you're going to do, right? But you didn't do it. So next time we're not voting for you. If they start getting the point, like, you know, this is how it's going to work, that, you know, if they put me in, and because we got the power to put him in and take him out. We do.
So here you are, and why don't we put on the short clip about the Burning House Project that you created and founded.
Right.
And we'll put that on, and we'll get an idea of what that's about, and then you'll tell us a little more about it and how you're trying to get that to be a program all around this city and the country.
Thank you.
This is Mel Blackman's Burning House Project.
My mom says to just drop down on the floor so I won't get you.
Anytime I see somebody arguing, I run, because I don't know what they're going to have or what they're going to do.
Wake up, everybody, no more sleeping in bed.
My mother said, don't ever go into a place where you can't get out. So then I don't go to the parks.
So very much from what it used.
I don't feel safe in my neighborhood.
There's so much hatred, war and poverty.
My name is Mel Blackman. I created the Burning House Project to take us on a new approach to consequential thinking.
Hello and welcome. My name's Errol Lewis, columnist for the New York Daily News and radio host on 1600 AM WWRL in New York. I've spent many, many years documenting what goes on in the neighborhoods of New York, and one of the most troubling things I've had to report on is the death toll, the body count, including even very young victims caught in crossfires, bludgeoned to death in certain cases, teen murders that go on. And what happens is that our young people are being attracted to gangs, they're being attracted to violence. They end up in jail, sometimes they end up hurt or dead. We've got to do something about it, and that's why the Burning House Project is so important. What you're gonna see on this film is an attempt to start a conversation about how we tamp down the level of violence, how we replace negative values with positive life-nurturing ones. It's all up to us. There's nobody else to help here, frankly. I hope that what you see here will inspire you to go out and continue the conversation.
I just want things to change so I can feel okay. I can feel like I live in a place where I enjoy to live in, but right now I don't.
I know what it means to have a house burning in my neighborhood. What it means is that my neighborhood's gonna be blighted, and the value of everything else in the neighborhood is gonna come down. The children have no role models to look up to. I mean, if they do have them, it's the violent guys, the negative behavior guys, and that's just a terrible thing. It just sort of perpetuates the problem. If each man raises his own child or children that he has in the right direction, we'll solve a lot of the problems that we have in our community. Everybody has to be responsible for their own, and we'll have a nice groundswell that goes up.
It took a long time for me to learn and understand that rather than, even with my good intentions, rather than being a part of the solution, that I was actually a part of the problem. Until we actually acknowledge and accept our responsibilities, the part that we play in the destruction in our communities, there's not going to be a change. I believe that the common denominator for change in our community is to focus on the children, period. if we focus on that, change will come.
When I was in the street, I was doing the same thing that some other parents are doing here. My oldest son is 34, and he's coming home soon after doing 10 years in jail because he was selling drugs. And I used to sell drugs, and I used to use drugs. The youngest one, who's 31, thank God that he's doing okay. He's working. He's a very different person, different personality, and he's very responsible. But in that community, especially us older adults, we need to take the responsibility and take care of our kids. Like they say that it takes a whole village to raise a kid. That's true.
Sometimes it's guns, and I'm not supposed to actually get near the guns, and sometimes they get near to me, and if I could hear it, I get very, very scared, or I just cry.
Well, just the other day, someone got shot across the street from my job, and I remember going home and my child saying to me, "Mommy, I wish we could move somewhere where I could be a child again." It's very scary, and for a child to just want to escape and go somewhere where they can just play and have fun, but can't do that in their own community because someone may be coming to just show off, some of it may be show off, or initiate, or I don't know what they're doing. However, I know the kids don't stand a chance in that kind of environment.
I would like things to be in my neighborhood, like to not sell drugs and take drugs and just make it make the world a happy place and make it a better place.
Sometimes I just want to be a kid, grow up in a neighborhood where I live and don't have to worry about, am I going to get shot? Is somebody going to jump me? Is somebody waiting downstairs to jump me? I don't know. Like, why would you want to jump somebody? To make yourself feel good or to prove something to somebody?
I know about the images. I know about violent behavior. I know about preying on individuals from your community because I was part of that problem at one time. We as a community need to help individuals unlearn their old destructive ways. And we need to guide them in development of new attitudes and positive patterns of thoughts and actions. And assist them with the search, once again, the search for identity on a safe social level. I just try to do my best because I definitely was a part of the problem. But today, I can say with all honesty, I'm part of the solution and I'm proud to be part of the solution.
I don't want to be mistaken and get shot because I like my life. So sometimes when I walk to school, I have to think about some of us males, we think that, oh, you stepped on my new sneakers, now I'm gonna hurt you. It's always another buy. It's like, you could buy another sneakers, but you can't get another life.
Beautiful, beautiful, Mel. Mm. That great work.
Yeah, did that a while ago.
Yeah, how did you get this idea? How did you begin to develop this?
I'm a former substance abuse counselor. I did that from 1993 to 2013 when I retired. And I'm also a former substance abuser, you know, up to March 7, 1986. I've been drug and alcohol free for 30 years. Mm. But when I was a counselor, and because this was done some years back, I think 2009 when I was done.
Okay.
And that's why Errol Lewis was still on, was still one of his jobs were on the radio still. But the what happened is that the on my job at a place called Addicts Rehabilitation Center in Harlem,
mm-hmm.
there was it's a 6 to 9 month drug program, and I'm residential. And part of my job was sending people out to look for, look for school or work, after their probation period.
Right.
But a lot of the people I'm dealing with, like people from the street and people on parole, a lot of parolees. And around that time, 2009, especially 2009, when Obama just first came in and inherited George Bush's mess, there was a whole lot of people that had jobs for 10, 20, 25 years, and they were being, put out of work, because of the economy.
Mm-hmm.
And they're out in the job market looking for jobs, any kind of jobs, along with the people that I'm sending out to look for jobs who have criminal records.
Right.
So, of course, it's hard for the people with criminal records to find any jobs, which is not an impossibility, because there's agencies that actually hire people, with criminal records, knowing their criminal background, depending on the nature of the crimes. But there's agencies, that do that. But when guys would come back to me and tell me, Mr. B, it's hard for me to find a job. I can't find a job. I might as well go back to doing what I was doing before, which was like a crime in some form or another, sticking people up. Mind you, our own people, right? Because it's all done in the community. Sticking people up, selling drugs, you name it, any kind of crime,
Mm-hmm.
And I said, if you go back to doing that, you probably get caught, and sent to prison, and rightfully so, because you're breaking the law and you're bringing down the quality of life in the community, But I would hear guys tell me that, I said, you might wind up doing 10 years. And I would hear, a lot of guys say that, I could do 10 years standing on my head. I could do prison time.
Wow.
But I already got to know these people, and I knew that they had little children, little grandchildren or nieces and nephews or whatever it is, right? I said, okay, well, how's your 2-year-old son do the 10 years while you're doing the 10 years? What that child needs from you, the mother can't give it to him. There's nobody can give him, what that child needs from you, So.
You mainly concentrate on men?
Mostly the men.
Okay.
Because, a lot of the guys would think that, my wife or my baby's mom, I hate that term, is holding it down, but I'm telling you, I said, that's one heck of a woman, to hold down your job and her job at the same time.
So I took it for granted that would happen.
Yeah.
And you were calling in their own responsibility.
Right. Yeah.
That they hadn't really
thought
about that.
Yeah.
Much.
So like from there, I said, let me take, if I want to find an abundance of people,
But how did you come up with this? It's brilliant.
The term?
Children. I mean, what made that connection? Was something in your own life, or
because I. But I came from I strayed, right?
Yeah.
I came from a upper middle class family. It was two family, two parent household.
Right.
Strict but fair, West Indian background. Yeah. So it wasn't. I didn't have a trouble childhood, but a lot of people in the neighborhood, they had the trouble background. But the thing is that I knew of situations like this because it, like I said, so many people that were involved in that disparity,
but the children, the connection, that is really so profoundly important. That link.
Well, yeah,
and
but
I think
that's
what really pulled at these guys.
No, but that's what
that's
what I was going to with because like the people that I did know,
right,
who's like say fathers were like it got involved with some sort of crime or something like that,
right?
And here I am 7, 8, 9 years old or something like that, and I'm thinking back, because I know that when little Johnny or Mary was acting out, in school or doing certain things, because like they didn't have that person at home, because like that the father, was away in prison, because they used to call it the person's away, So we knew what that meant. That's why when people are coming home from prison, they say they're coming home, But like usually people think somebody's coming home, he's thinking they're coming home from work, right? But no, they're coming home from prison. Mm. But then, as I'm getting older. And I'm seeing the results on the children, right?
Right.
Because that person is not there, you know.
Right.
So like, I mean, all this stuff came back to me, you know.
Right.
Because like I said, I'm in the field now in 1993, and I got off drugs in 1986. So my mind is clear now. So like, things are starting to come back, you know.
You're seeing the new generation growing.
Yeah. Yeah. But I remember the little kids, you know, like when I was a kid, and the certain behaviors, you know, that I saw back then, right? Because this person wasn't there. The father wasn't there, and it manifests itself in so many different ways. You know, like and it's clear cut that the influence on the little kid. But the reason I focus on the very youngest child is because we can turn things around. You know, if people start saying like, now wait a minute, like, you know, would you commit that crime again? Right, you know, knowing what can happen to this little, you know, to this little kid, because like here you have a 2-year-old, and because like that's why the commissioner at the time, New York State Department of Corrections, he had told me in a correspondence, you know, like, I should try to make this a reentry program, because I don't want people going into prison, seeing how they mess their kid up. You know, I want them coming out saying like, well, you can't, if you come when you're coming out of prison, because that's why right now, it's a reentry program in New York State. I did a pilot program with great results in Queensboro, you know. But the when people coming out thinking that if I mess up, it's not so much that I'm gonna go back to jail and do prison time again, but here's what it's gonna do to my little kid, because
that's the genius of it that hits these older men in a way that nothing else
and the younger men too. Yeah, right.
Yes,
yeah.
Exactly.
Yeah.
That nothing else had seemed that did this.
No, because like when people go in the prison, but say people from the urban community, right? They figure, well, you know, I can handle it, you know, because they can go in there, you know, they know they tough enough,
exactly.
Or they can handle,
exactly.
You know, the fights, they can handle, you know, the situations, you know, they can put on some weight and stuff like that. I can handle, I can do prison, right? Fine, you can do prison, right? But when to get back to Brian Fisher, the reason he said that. I should make a reentry program, because one of the things I used to say, you know, and we used to correspond a lot. I used to tell the guys in the rehab when they were talking about going back to crime. I said, okay, now suppose, you know, you have a 2-year-old, you know, which the person did have a 2-year-old, and you're about to do 10 years, you know, because like you went back to doing something like that again, selling drugs or whatever it is, and you got caught. I said, what would it be like, you know, that you're in the first year of your 10-year term? And you get a call from home saying that the new boyfriend, because there is going to be a new boyfriend, right? The new boyfriend is inappropriately touching your 2-year-old. There's nothing you can do because you're not going anywhere for the next 10 years, you know? Mm-hmm. So you need to be there. You need to not commit the crime.
Protect and nurture your child.
Right. Yeah, you need to be there. I mean, even like your if you're from your upbringing, you might have some dysfunction in you, right? It's better off than not being there at all. You know, like at least you can learn. You know, and you're open to learn. You know, something while you're outside. If you keep that child in mind,
mm-hmm.
You know, because like if the child is 10 years old or something like that, it's a different story. Well, he can handle it himself, right?
So that child, in a sense, is healing, helping
right.
to heal the adult.
It is, yeah.
And from the traumas and
right.
It's amazing.
If you keep that in mind.
Right.
Yeah, because like
And strength of the community.
Yeah, and absolutely, because if Jim Vrettos as a 2-year-old, right, and Jim Vrettos is a ex-offender, and when Jim Vrettos wants to do something again that he knows that might put him in jeopardy or even get killed in the process,
mm-hmm.
right?
Mm-hmm.
Jim Vrettos is not thinking so much. Well, you know, I could handle a bullet or I can handle jail time, right?
Mm.
I'm telling Jim Vrettos, okay, here's what this little kid's gonna go through.
Which I couldn't handle.
Yeah, right. See, that's the key to the Burning House Project. You know, the reason I called the Burning House Project was the crimes. Like I said, it said in some of the writing, the crimes and the negative behaviors is the fire. You know, and a lot of times people like to, especially my folks, right, and rightfully so, because it does play a part. They talk about slavery and mm-hmm. things like that, right? But if the situation in American society, which is a racist society, basically, right, is the problem, and certain people started this ball rolling a long time ago, right? I'm not going to help anybody that's still thinking like that, like Donald Trump's people, right?
Right.
I'm not going to help them out by by doing more stuff to my own people.
You can't worry about them. What you can do is help your own.
Fix my own,
your own community.
Yeah, because I'm not going to help, you know, because...
Because they're too far gone, in a sense.
They've been going. Because like
going further.
That's
further,
one of the things. I didn't mention this to you before, Jim, but one of the things, and I shock people when I say things, because you know I can say some things that catch people off guard. I said one of the good things that came out of Donald Trump is the fact that all these people that with all and even the powerful people or the racist people that were always there. He brought them out into the public, because now they're all in your face. Every time you look around, here they are. They're right there, because they were always there. He didn't create them. They were always there. Mm. But my thing is, like, if we know this is the problem, what are we doing to each other? I mean, we run around shooting each other. You know, we're beating up each other. You know, we're doing all kind of stuff to each other, right?
And so you're creating a sort of unity. Now I see the connection that you referred to before with the Hasidic community.
Right.
Not that we have to agree with every policy they're
trying to,
but it's
a unity.
This unity.
Yeah.
That's what's so important. And healthiness.
It is because I grew
sense of love and nurturing for each other.
Yeah, because I grew up, and this is no secret to anybody black, but you know, we've heard this, you know, for years. You've heard it yourself, right? You know. People say, well, you know how those Jews are, you know, they all stick together, right?
Mm-hmm.
And my point is like, well, isn't that the point? I mean, like, there's nothing, if you're against somebody else, that's a problem, right? But if you're Italian and you're pro-Italian, I heard a young lady say that a long time ago, right? What's wrong with being pro-Italian? What's wrong with being pro-black? What's wrong with being, you know, pro-Jew or pro-Islamic? There's nothing wrong with that. When you start pointing some fingers at some other folks and down some other folks, that's a problem, right? But you're supposed to be for your people, you know, sticking together.
That's a whole other show.
Yeah, yeah.
With Rabbi Lerner, who is calling out certain segments of the, particularly the Israeli government,
right.
and Jewish segments
right.
who don't, he doesn't believe, are really living a true prophetic life. The Old Testament says to love the neighbor, the neighbor and the other, and so on. They're not. But anyway, that's I get what you're saying there.
But he mentioned that also, because he said at the very outset of his speech that don't blame the whole Islamic community for the actions of a few,
or the Jewish community, or any community,
or the Jewish community, just like what you just said, for the actions of some. That doesn't make any sense, you know, because that's the problem. You know, people are blaming a whole group of people for the accident of like a handful over here. You know, because everybody's not like that, and you know that.
And of course, that's what Trump and other demagogues are so skilled at doing, to divide and conquer.
Yeah.
That's how they stay in power.
Yeah.
And Bill Clinton, of course, has famously done that as he was confronted by Black Lives Matter, totally distorting. And Hillary was not much better on that. Turning the problem into something that they had, rather than deal with their own involvement in creating the policies that were very negative. But so your program is so positive now. It, as you say, it's a reentry program now. So you have trained counselors. You work with. How does this operate?
Well, no. See, right now, I'm in the process of, because it's only been myself going into these different entities and prisons, because just myself doing it, because of a lack of funding.
But you've had a lot of support. You've had a lot of people that say this is terrific.
Yeah. As a matter of fact, I was a guest speaker last week at the Brooklyn DA's office. That was like that was on the first of this month, and I mentioned, because somebody had asked a question about with my prison program, which I started doing one day presentations from as far back as 2008, right?
Mm-hmm.
And because Governor Cuomo stepped in and made them give me the reentry program, so that was as of the beginning of 2015, where I did five separate groups of five, you know, I have a five-part curriculum, you know, five different classes.
Mm-hmm.
And I did five groups of those at Queensborough facility.
Okay. Yeah, and the prison.
Yeah, and what it is that everybody up from 2008 up to 2015, all the incarcerated men said the same thing. This is the best approach to the urban violence and negativity they've ever seen. So the question that was asked to me,
right.
well, listen, like, you know, do I have any documentation, you know, about, or like, you know, for people who went out and didn't recidivate and stuff like that? I'm saying,
right.
How could I? If I said, because I had approval from the experts as far back as 2008. Now, when I say the experts, I'm talking about the people who were incarcerated.
Exactly.
Because, like, they're telling
they're
me.
They're the ones that think they're this
telling
works.
You, yeah, this. And
this
I,
is the one
and
thing
now,
that
right,
does
but and
it.
Now I even have surveys, yeah. Right, that show from the groups I did in Queensboro, that because what if, mind you, what if I'm doing a group, right? In a group, say there's sometimes there's more, but like so it says there's 15 people, right? Let's say 10. If I have a group of 10 men in a prison, right, they right. represent at least 200 years of incarceration,
mm-hmm.
by themselves. You know, and the thing is that. There's a lot of programs that they've been through all these years, and if they're telling the people with the suits and ties, like I call them, right?
Yeah.
That this is
or
the best one.
Empty suits. And
this
ties,
is the yeah. best one we've ever seen, approaching you know like the violence, right? This is the best one, right? So I said, so what is the problem? I said, you know, the experts are telling you this is the best that they've ever seen. You know, so don't get me started.
No.
Yeah.
Well,
yeah.
You do want to get you started.
Yeah.
But no, you sound in an interesting way.
Yeah.
A lot like Michael Lerner.
Yeah. Yeah.
Who is reaching out and gets overwhelming response.
Right.
By
right.
the experts, by right.
the people
of the world.
Yeah. Right.
And yet we still are at loggerheads with the established powers that be.
Yeah.
Still.
Yeah.
Although we're beginning to, you know, break that down, hopefully,
yeah.
and as the old order dies, and,
right.
and as we imagine these new programs that you are so skillfully articulating,
yeah.
you're really onto something. Just as I think Michael is,
and
the response is overwhelmingly favorable. So
yeah.
So again, it is a struggle that I see you participating in, and.
Yeah.
Making progress on, and certainly the community itself, the people that you are
right.
talking to, want more of it.
Absolutely. And I even have things in place. I already have the people in place. See, I have a staff of people in place already. You know, I mean, they're working on their jobs, but I already have people who I would employ. I have there's certain things I would have. I would have the class, just like in the prison, but in a different way. I would have you know the setting. Sure, and the thing that the main thing that makes it work is because it's done with respect. And I'm not telling people, here's what you need to do.
Mm-hmm.
They're actually telling me, here's our answers. Because the people have the answers already. I said, you know, that's why we need to stop asking politicians.
They're opening up to you and to themselves.
And to themselves.
To their children.
Right,
and
mainly, yeah.
Loving and nurturing right. and healing.
Right.
The community and themselves
right.
and the kids at the same time.
Yeah.
And that's what Michael was talking about with Tikkun. And by the way, we're going to have, when Michael is having the 30th anniversary of Tikkun
okay.
magazine, in we're working on a conference in hopefully mid-November at
okay.
Riverside Church. So we're trying to put together, again, the organization, the power structure that needs to be
right.
set up to set this in motion more.
Right.
And just as you need to do. So we need to put you guys together.
Yes,
and
please.
And become
oh, yeah.
part of this
yeah.
wonderful attempt to really heal a community. And
yeah.
So any final thoughts on that struggle here as we sort of wind
well,
down the show here?
Actually, you just...
How do we get in touch with you?
Okay, I have a website, theburninghouseproject.com, right? It's just a little basic website.
Mm-hmm.
But my email is, I think my email is on the website, but it's Numel, N-U-M-E-L, at Verizon.net. Anybody could email me there. And I think all my information is on the website, theburninghouseproject.com. And
okay.
You said the final word was basically...
Sure.
Like you said, what the rabbi was saying is the same thing I'm saying. Like, we have to heal ourselves, you know. Because we keep asking people to heal us. You know, we need to heal ourselves, you know. And then with their cooperation, it could happen a little faster. But first
right.
we have to, like, you know, take a look and say, like, you know, we need to stop Even though we don't always see eye to eye, like Minister Farrakhan is the one who was always saying things like, you know, why we keep us as color, the people of color, keep asking other people for stuff that we already have.
Understood. And I think that's very, very important. That's a profound point.
Yeah.
Mel, thank you so very much.
Thank you.
For being here, for carrying on the struggle. I know we've known each other for many, many years,
yeah.
And we'll continue on in the struggle. Mm. And thank you so very much for appearing on The Radical Imagination, in which you will be hearing every week, Sunday at 8 p.m., more of these alternative progressive policies and programs and creative, wonderful people like Mel, who are out there in the forefront, are on the cutting edge of bringing about a new and much more loving world. See you next week. This is Jim Vrettos, your host on The Radical Imagination.